Our text is from Acts chapter 2. In Jesus' name, amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Well, what has Easter meant to you in the week just past? It was unlike any Easter I've ever experienced. So many of the traditional events were gone, or at least different, minimized. Maybe some special foods, but not a whole loaded table with all the family gathered. Maybe an egg hunt, but with family only. Maybe some chocolate, some hard-boiled or colored eggs. But worship via the internet. No church Easter breakfast. Lots of other changes. In the midst of all the changes, what has our Lord's resurrection meant to you? Well, thank goodness for something unchanging. Christ's resurrection is the reason we live in hope, even or maybe especially during a pandemic. Our text for today is not part of the current lectionary, the appointed readings from Lutheran service book for this day. It was the appointed first reading for the second Sunday of Easter from our previous hymnal, Lutheran Worship. I chose it because this reading continues on into what will be next week our first reading from Acts as well. All of it is part of Peter's sermon on the day of Pentecost. We heard a little bit of Peter talking and the other disciples talking when later on, after Pentecost, they had been arrested more than once, and their message to the authorities who had arrested them. These words come after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the disciples. Remember what took place that day: a sound of a mighty wind, tongues as of fire, an ability to speak the gospel of Jesus in languages of at least 15 different nations or ethnic groups that had people gathered in Jerusalem. But there was one other gift of the Holy Spirit, the gift of a new attitude. Peter and the other disciples had this new attitude. I'm going to call it living in hope, a most powerful hope, because the resurrection of Christ meant the promise of the resurrection for them as well. No matter what might happen to them, no longer would they cower behind locked doors. Now they were living in hope. I'm going to read the text and then I'll go on. Starts with a snippet from Acts 2 verse 14, and then it jumps ahead to 22 to 32. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them. And then verse 22. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know, this Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also will dwell in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades, nor let your Holy One see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. That's the end of David's quote. Peter says, brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Being therefore a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we all are witnesses. We see this attitude, a new attitude, living in hope, in the words of verse 14 describing what Peter did. He raised his voice. It means he spoke out boldly with powerful words. Well, we know Peter as one who spoke out, often hastily or brashly, but here is a change. He now speaks out boldly because of what the message meant for him and for the others. He spoke out boldly because he was living in hope, hope of what the resurrection meant for him. Peter quotes here King David from Psalm 16. David lived in hope because of the Lord. He said the Lord was always with him. That means leading him. The Lord was at David's right hand, helping him, supporting him. Because of that, David would not be shaken, but would stand firm in faith. And we know David went against a lot of hostility and a lot of troubles in his life. Therefore, David has a glad heart and a rejoicing tongue. His body would live in hope because the Lord was with him. Another translation might say, rest in hope. Now, the word for live or rest is a Greek word that comes from living in a tent. It brings the idea of a temporary residence. You know, in this case, temporary is not a bad thing. David is talking about his body having hope throughout his earthly life, recognizing that this life is temporary, because he trusted that his body would not be abandoned in the grave. Even the grave would be a temporary residence, because the Father would not let the Son, the Holy One, see decay. By inspiration of the Holy Spirit, David was given a prophetic glimpse of Christ's resurrection, and David's glimpse took place 1,000 years before Christ's resurrection. Maybe he didn't understand it all, but David knew something about what that resurrection meant for him. It meant there would also be an end to David's body being in the grave. Peter says his grave is here to this day. It means his body is in there, his corpse or the bones, whatever was left after 1,000 years. But David's body would not be in the grave forever. He would not be abandoned forever. And that word abandoned is from the same Greek word used to translate Jesus' Aramaic words from the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me, or abandoned me? Our Lord was forsaken on the cross, carrying our sins, suffering for David and suffering for us, so that David and we will not be forsaken or abandoned in the grave. David lived in this hope because God showed him the path of life, the way to eternal life. It was through trusting in God's promise of the coming Holy One, the Messiah. David lived in hope because of the Holy One. David would live in joy in God's presence forever because of that Holy One. Peter is saying that he now lived in the same hope, hope built on the resurrection of Jesus. Peter announces that he and the other disciples were eyewitnesses of the fact of the resurrection. And tonight's gospel, we heard how they were cowering behind locked doors because of fear of the Jews. Some of them had seen Jesus during the day. Just before this, I think the Emmaus disciples may have gotten back and told the rest that they had seen Jesus. But Jesus suddenly appears in that locked room the first Easter evening. And then we know that Thomas wasn't there with them, and he doesn't believe that it's true until he sees it for himself. Eyewitnesses. Peter announces that he and the other disciples were eyewitnesses of the fact of the resurrection. This is happening 50 days after Easter, the day of Pentecost, 50 days later. And by this time, not only the 12 disciples, but the scriptures tell us at one time up to a group of 500 believers saw Jesus all at once in those 40 days between Easter and Ascension. these eyewitnesses of the fact of the resurrection, along with the gift of the Holy Spirit, gave them the boldness to speak openly in public about the Lord and his resurrection. And that boldness would even carry them through times when they were arrested, like the first reading we heard tonight from Acts chapter 5. They would not stop talking about Jesus, even though they had been arrested multiple times, and even though they were told not to do it. They were not going to stop speaking openly about the Lord and his resurrection. Well, we live in a world that is desperate for hope. You know, the world is pretty desperate for hope at any time, probably even more so now due to this pandemic. We hear of medical advances, even ones that are supposedly being sought out for this disease. And there's all kinds of medical changes that have happened in our lifetimes. I'm barely old enough, when I was a baby, was in the midst of the polio things, when 60,000 people a year would die in our country because of polio. But I don't remember that personally. Some of you do. We hear of all kinds of medical advances. Probably some of us here are still alive when we would have been gone long before in previous generations because of the medicines we take or the surgeries we've had or whatever it might be. But yet in the end, every one of us is terminal. We are all bound to die someday. Our homes are filled with time-saving appliances and machines, and yet, at least the way it was before, we often find ourselves too busy for the really important things. Constant efforts to bring peace to our world, and yet fighting continues, even grows worse from time to time. We live with so many blessings, luxuries, and yet we so often lack joy in life. We need to turn to this Pentecost preaching of Peter and the soothing song of the psalm writer, David. Here is the basis for hope for you and me. I'm going to read the words of the psalm now, kind of paraphrased, sort of my own paraphrase of it. So I hope it's close to being the way it should be. I see the Lord always before me, leading me. Because he is always at my right hand, that means helping me, strengthening me, I will not be shaken, and I'm going to stand firm in the faith. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest in hope. My body will rest in hope during this temporary life because something is coming that's going to fulfill that hope in the future. You will not abandon me in the grave because you did not let your Holy One see decay. David looked forward to one who would rise from the dead, and that gave him hope that his body would not be in the grave forever. In Jesus' death and resurrection, David looked forward and said, "You have made known to me the way to eternal life." And it's because of that eternal life that he could write, "You fill me with joy in your presence forever." That was David's hope. That was Peter's hope. And it's the hope in which we live, all because of Jesus and his resurrection. And so we say, Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in this Christ Jesus. Amen. We sing the remaining three verses of hymn 470, 7, 8, and 9. 470.
He saw the feet, the hands, the side. Christ our